Shabbat Shalom one more time. And I just want to say that the parasha of this morning is known as Parasha Shemini. I repeat again, Parasha Shemini. And I subtitle it The Selfless Service. The Selfless Service. Parasha Shemini relates four main subjects. First, the parasha relates the sacrifice offered to Adonai in the sanctuary on the eighth day by Aaron and his sons after the 7 days of inauguration of the sanctuary by Moshe. That is chapter 9. Secondly, the parasha relates the tragic death of Nadab and Abihu, the two elder sons of Aaron, through the igniting of alien fire inside the sanctuary. Chapter 10, from verse 1 to 11. And thirdly, the parasha relates the manner of the eating / non-eating of the sacrifices by Aaron and his two remaining sons after the death of Nadab and Abihu on the day of them becoming mourners. Chapter 10 from verse 12 to 20. And fourthly, the last one, the parasha details the law regarding pure and impure animals. This is a saying from our great sages, and I repeat, a saying from our great sages. This week, parasha opened with the dedication of the Mishkan. We read in chapter 9, verse 7, Moses said to Aaron, approach the Mishbash, which is the altar, and perform the service. Rashi explained, Aaron was ashamed to approach. Moses said to him, why are you ashamed? For this you were choosing. Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman elaborates, Aaron was sanctified to Adonai. He had no sin on his conscience except for the making the golden calf. But that sin was always at the forefront of his thought. Moshe therefore told him, have some pride and do not be so humble, for Adonai has already forgiven you. What is what I'm trying to tell us this morning, that after the inauguration of the 7 day inauguration, in which Moshe Rabbeinu has already taught Aaron and his sons on how to do what, to perform the sacrifices, all the Qurban that are necessary. He taught them during these 7 days when they were all of them are locked up in the sanctuary, teaching them one by one on how to perform these sacrifices. And when it comes to the 8th day, and this is the day that Moshe Rabbeinu also hand over unto Aaron his brother the services and the duty of the Mishkan. For we remember that Moshe Rabbeinu has served as Kohen Gadol on the first day when he anointed Aaron and his sons as Kohen Gadol, and so therefore he finished his own duty. And now the duty now that is remaining is for Aaron to now aspire as the Kohen Gadol and his sons to sanctify the people of Israel before God. And on this particular day, it was what, according to what the Torah said, that Aaron was a little bit, you know, like back-footed, you know. It was not like, you know, and it was like somewhere like afraid to do it, according to our sages, saying that he was always thinking about his wrongdoing that he has did before, that or that he has done before, which is the sacrifice that he made during the troubling time in the desert when they just came out from Egypt, about the golden calf. So to this, he was always ashamed and afraid about it. He was always at the backbone of his mind. But Moshe, his brother, was encouraging him, telling him, enough is enough. God has forgiven you. This is the time. This is your time. You have to come up. You have to overcome that barrier. You have to overcome all those thoughts and now come out and do the service which God has called you to do. Rabbi Shlomo writes, it is true that our sages have taught in Avot chapter 4, be very, very humble. We see here, however, that there is a limit to humility. When humility impedes the person's service of Adonai, it is no longer appropriate. The first key to serve Adonai is to recognize one's worth and importance. This is stated expressly in the work of Share Ha'Avodah, which is attributed to Rabbi Yonan Geradis. The first step is for the person who is serving Adonai to know his own worth, to recognize his elevated level and the elevated level of his forefathers and their greatness and importance to the Creator and his affection for them. A person should then always strive and strengthen himself to live up to that level and to allow and to always act accordingly. If God forbid a person does not recognize his level and that of his ancestor, he can easily go in the way of lawless people. That is it's written in the book of Shorei Chumash. So what I'm trying to tell us here is that it is very, very important for one to know his level. You have to understand if the Holy One, blessed be He, has called you to do His service. That is, you are worthy before Him. That is why He called you. If you are not worthy before Him, He won't call you. If you are not worthy to carry the burden, He won't even call you in the first place. But because the Holy One, blessed be He, has called you to carry this burden, and He has called each and every one of us to carry the burden of the Torah, it is possible if we are worthy by Him. That is why He has called us to His service, to serve Him in the world, in the Mishkan. We are serving the Holy One, blessed be He, in His Mishkan by our actions and by what we do every day. It is because I want us to recognize and know that each and every one of us is a Mishkan of the living God, as it is written that we are the temple of the living God. We and each and every one of us are the temple of the living God, as Rabbi Shaul said. If we want to serve God in spirit and in truth, we have to do that God has called us to do. He loves you and He is in need of you. That's why He has called you to His service. And you have to do that He has called you according to the word that He has called you with. But if you are now afraid or ashamed to serve Him, let me tell you that God has thousands and millions of people that He can call. Don't belittle yourself. That's what I'm trying to tell us. Do not belittle yourself. Come out. Don't be ashamed. Say, you know what? I don't know what my friend will talk about me, what my father will say about me, what my brothers or my sister will say about me, that, oh, you are now one of them who believe in the Torah, you are now one of them who believe there is God. Don't you have a PhD? Are you not educated? Why are you behaving like those non-educated people believing in some creator? They might want to disturb you. You might be thinking in your mind. But there is a reason God has called you. Maybe in your family there is darkness, and God has chosen you as a light to that family, as a light to that state, as a light to that country, as a light to that village, as a light to that town, so that they will see through you the power and the redeeming grace of the Almighty God. Well, we have to do that to elevate ourselves to the statue of our forefathers. We have to stand firm and be strong in our resolve to serve the living God. For now, it will suffice to state the general rule that sacrifices were brought to the sanctuary, that is in the temple, in the daytime, morning and afternoon, and never at evening or at night. The Mishbah was kept alight at night, and part of the sacrifice continued to burn upon it, but the sacrifice themselves were not performed at night time. Moreover, in Judaism, day begins in the evening, as it is written in the account of creation, and it was evening and it was morning. Aaron did not officiate as the high priest until the second of Nisan. On the first of Nisan daytime, he brought his sacrifices and the sacrifice of to Moshe, who officiated as the high priest. Thus, Moses served as high priest for a day. However, from this verse we learn that the daytime of the first month, the eighth day, is when the sanctuary will be fully inaugurated, as opposed to the night time of the 8th day. In Judaism, the night time comes before the daytime, as it is written that in the that was darkness and void, right, in the history of creation, and God commanded light to come from darkness, and there was light. So the same thing in Hebrew, that in our culture, in our tradition, a day starts from the evening time, right? So from the night comes the day. So that is what we're trying to say. And in this part, I was trying to tell us that Moshe Rabbeinu officiates for 8 days. So and in the evening they do, that's not in the night, we don't do sacrifices in the night, only in the evening and in the morning. So but part of the sacrifices will continue to be burned upon the altar throughout the night. So on the 8th day, that is we all understand the gematria of the letter 8, which is a new start, a new beginning. So this is a new start now in the history of the people of Israel, where a Kohen Gadol will be chosen and will be officially its service before the living God. And on this day, there is something that happens. So let's see. The Midrash Torah Kohanim interprets, Moshe said to Bnei Israel, remove that certain Yetzerah from your heart and be unified in your desire to serve God, just as He is one, so your service will be uniquely for Him. If you do this, then the glory of Adonai will appear to you, until here from the Midrash. What is this certain Yetzerah? Rabbi Yitzhak explained, citing several Hasidic works. When Bnei Israel heard that Adonai would reveal himself to them on that day, that is the day of the dedication of the Mishkan, their heart burned with impatient anticipation. That was the Yetzerah to which Moshe referred, for it means that their service of Adonai was motivated by a desire to attain lofty spiritual level, not a desire to simply do God's will. Moses said, if you want the glory of Adonai to appear to you, then you must serve God only because this is the thing that Adonai has commanded you to do. So this is what I'm just trying to explain, that there are most of us that have the desire to serve God, but to lift up the name of God, to do everything that God has commanded. But the point is that, what is our motive? A lot of people have different motive by which they want to serve God. Most people want the motive of respect, because they want respect from the people. Some people, their motive is just to show up their knowledge. Some people, their motive is for financial gain. Some people, their motive is, we have different motives. But God is saying, what is your motive of serving me? What is the motive that you have in your heart to serve the living God? Do you want to serve God because God is your master? Or you want to serve God because of another thing? But this is what the Holy One, blessed be He, is asking us. That we should serve Him because He's our creator. Because we are His children. Because He created us in His own image. In the image of God created He man. So therefore, if you want to serve God because we have another motive, or because we have another hidden agenda, then that service is not acceptable before God. In a related thought, Rabbi Zvi Elimelech writes about the commandment not to ascend to the Mishbar, which is the altar, on step. In my opinion, This mitzvah hints that a person should not seek lofty spiritual level such as Ruach HaKodesh or the revelation of Eliyahu Hanavi. If he is honored by heaven with such attainment, he should thank Adonai, for he is good. However, one's only intention should be to serve Adonai out of love and awe and with simplicity, as a son serves his father and mother. If God forbid a person thinks he is worthy of lofty level, his account book will be opened in heaven and his name will be revealed. Therefore, a person should be content to do what he is commanded by God to do. So what I'm trying to say here is that our main job, as I just explained, our main job is to serve our God, our Creator, with all our might, with all our soul, with all our resources, as it is written in Shema Israel. But if God had decided to lift you up to become one of His princes, then that is the desire of the Almighty. So you have to walk to do what? To walk up to that level. You don't have to restrain yourself. You don't have to be ashamed of because the Holy One, blessed be He, has called you, or you start looking of what other will say about you. They say, oh, you know, he's not worthy, or he's not the type of person that God can use. You know, he was a criminal, he steal, this and that. No, it is not their problem. God, the Holy One of Israel, blessed be He, has called you to His service. So you have to do what? Obey Him. You don't have to obey what man talks about you. But because of, or rather, you have to do that which the Holy One, blessed be He, has called you to do. Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, each took his pan, put fire in them, and placed incense upon it. And they brought fiery fire before God, which He had not commanded. This is Vayikra chapter 10, verse 1. Most of us probably read this as if it has nothing to do with us. Nadab and Abihu made a great mistake and lost their life because of it, greatly deepening the entire experience of one of the greatest moments in history, the inauguration of the Mishkan. How could they have been so wrong at so important moment? Then Moshe Rabbeinu turned the entire thing on his head while we're shaking our head in disdain and disbelief. Moshe told Aaron that his son's act and death revealed that Nadab and Abihu were actually greater than even the two of them. The dike sanctifies God's name. And while we stretch our head in utter confusion, we might happen to take a look at Shia Agigulim to find out just how important Nadab and Abihu were. Their physical life may have been short, but their spiritual life were long and meaningful. So what I'm trying to say is that during the time of this inauguration, after the 7 days that they've been taught, you know, by Moshe, he has taught Aaron and his son on how to do the service and perform all the sacrifices, the one that go to sacrifice, the one that go to burn, and the one that go to eat. Now, on the day where the whole Easter, the eyes of the people were upon them, this tragedy struck. What is the tragedy? The tragedy of an Abihu by them taking a foreign fire, taking an alien fire before the temple of the Most High to offer a sacrifice that they were not commanded. These two men were not commanded to do this. So the point is that what happened? Why did they try to do this? What comes over them? What is the meaning of this? Why did they decide to go before the presence of the Most High, the presence of the King of Kings, when they were not called Him? So what happens in their mind that makes them to think that it is right or it is good to do this? Rabbi Moshe was telling Aaron, his brother, that even though the death of Nadab and Abihu is that they are greater in their death than in their life because they sanctifies the name of the Most High, as it is written that God will sanctify Himself, right, by those that are closer to Him. The Holy One, blessed be He, will sanctify His name by those that are closer to Him. What does that mean? What is God telling us to? What is God trying to tell us in this phrase? He's telling us that we that call ourselves the minister of the Messiah, we that call ourselves a rabbi, we that call ourselves the servant of God, that God will sanctify His name in us than the rest of people. Which means that we have been lifted up into a particular high status. and and God himself will require double and triple and quadruple more steps from us than the rest of the people. Because you have been taught, you understand the principle, you understand how the spiritual realm works. But for ordinary people who don't understand, God does not expect much from them. But as from us that have been taught, God is expecting a higher status, a higher level of understanding of how to approach Him. God, as it is said, that God is a consuming fire. You can't just bump in into the presence of God without a reverence, without an honor. Even though in your father's room, you can't just bump into your parents' room without you knocking. And it is written in the book of Esther that even though the queen cannot come before the king without the king requesting an audience. That is what I'm trying to tell us here, that Nadab and Abihu's action was like the action of a drunkard. And that is what the Torah speaks about. Immediately after their death, it talks about non-drinking. What is Adonai the Most High trying to tell us here about this? In my humble opinion, I don't think that, because most of our Midrash states that Nadab and Abihu were killed because they were drunk, taking fire offering, an alien fire offering before the Most High God. But in my humble opinion, to me, I don't think that they were drunk. I think that what actually happened was because, according to what the Torah said, that this is your sacrifice that you shall make. And when they make the sacrifice, Moses and God will reveal himself unto you. So God revealed himself unto them, and they saw the awesomeness, the greatness, and the might of the Almighty God. They saw the heavenly rings. They saw the way the heavens were operating. They saw the blessedness of the heavens. They saw all the beauty of the heaven. And so they become intoxicated with this. They want this experience more and more. They want this experience every time. They want this to be a kind of, Moshe Rabbeinu has shown us the formula. We know the formula on how to approach God, and we know the formula on how to access the heavens. We know the formula on how to do all kinds of miracles. So therefore, I don't need any person to tell me what to do. I can just do this formula and the result will come. It's like you saying that, I can go and bust myself in the presence of the Prime Minister any other time that I want. No. You, the Almighty God, the Most High God, gave you access unto himself through his servant Moshe. But in this, in their own action, Moses wasn't there. They just want to bump themselves before the presence of God uncommanded or unrequested for. So this is their mistake. And that is why the Torah speaks about not drinking at all from that day on when they want to come into the presence of the Almighty. There must not be any alcohol in them, because their action is like the action of an addict who is addicted to a particular thing that anytime that you want, you can just go and get it. A drug addict, when he wants a drug, he go and get a drug and inject. A drunkard will want to be drunk because the alcohol, he need more alcohol in his body, he go and get drunk and is happy. But then that is not the service of God, and that is not what God is talking about. God is talking about holiness here. We need to understand that God is holy, and whosoever will serve God has to be the same thing, has to be holy. As God had said that I am holy, and so therefore you shall be holy. You shall be what? You shall be separated as the Lord our God is separated. And we have to do what? Have reverence, respect to the Almighty. We can't just bump in his presence anytime that we want. We have to be sober in whatsoever we do before we come before him. But as the Talmud states, at the end of the journey, we still have to come back to what the Torah say on the simplest of level, and that is that Nadab and Abihu offer a foreign fire before God which he had not commanded them. And ironically, COVID-19 has made this verse more relevant to us than it has been in a long time if ever. I have spent more time washing my hand in the past few weeks than I have in the last year. My mother always told me to wash my hands with soap every morning after waking up from my sleep, which I faithfully do till now. The question is to what extent a person at a time of crisis needs to put his health and clearly the health of others at risk to fulfill a mitzvah in the ideal manner. It is called mesirat nefesh, self-sacrifice for God and Torah. When the person breaks the rule from the health ministry, so he can go to a minyan to make a brief with friends or to participate in a hasana. What I'm trying to say here that this message of this morning, which is this parasha Shemini, brought to us this event that is taking place at the present. The problem of the COVID-19 virus, this coronavirus that is everywhere now. Why am I saying this? What I'm trying to what I'm saying is that at the present time we see people, even our own people, that are neglecting the message of the government. The government is asking us to do what? To isolate ourselves. The government is asking us to stay home so that we won't infect others or that we won't be infected. So, but we see most of our own people, they disregard this. They don't even want to even listen, okay, because this is what the Torah said. But the problem is that, yes, the Torah said that we should do what? Go to a minyan, which is the temple, go to the synagogue, or go to have a group of people for us to gather and praise his name. Yes. This is true, but the point is, at the moment, there is a health crisis. There is a problem that which the government is saying that we should restrict ourselves from what? From going outside, from being infected or infecting others. So, to what level can we disagree with the government stand? And I want us to remember now that even though the Torah said that every power that's in place is put there by God, no man can just become a prime minister or a president at his own will. We might say, oh, they manipulated the election, it is some shadow government, you know, who or some underground controller who's controlling them, who brings them into power. But one thing I want us to understand for firm and for true is that without God it will not be possible. It is God that made them to be there. So therefore, if God wants them to be there, it is up for us to do to obey their regulation if it concerns our own health and our own well-being. Because the peace of the country is our own peace. The good health of the country is our own good health. It has to do with what is called a frum yetzera. That is Yesera that knows it can't get a person to commit an outright sin. The person is too from, or the person is too wise for that. So instead, he finds a way to turn a mitzvah into a sin, and a sin into a mitzvah. This way, the person can believe that his action, which is really a sin, is a mitzvah. The problem is in the gray area. Am I really that sick or that contagious? Isn't there some positive purpose in speaking this Loshara? What are the odds that I have the virus or that I will get it if I go to the synagogue? If I don't report all my income, then I will have more money for tzedakah, etc. In the word of one of the most famous rabbi, what does God say? After all, it is mitzvah we are supposed to be doing, not our own version of them. If God is God, who have to please not some inner definition of who we are or what we have to do. Many people think they know the answer to that question when in fact they do not, and they therefore act incorrectly. So what I'm trying to tell us here is that there is a form of a yesara the evil inclination of man that makes a person to do what to make a person to commit an outright sin. And how does it do that? It makes you to believe that you are performing a mitzvah and when you are committing a sin. That is what I'm trying to tell us here. And so therefore, because the Yetzirah knew that this man is so smart that this man will not commit a sin outrightness, so he make it look, he decorate it, he paint it as if you are making a mitzvah. He said, you know, because the mitzvah is that we have to go before we have to go to the synagogue every Shabbat. So if you don't go, you know, if you don't go to the synagogue, you are committing a sin. But the government is saying stay home. You say, oh no, I won't obey the government, you know. Why should I stay home? Today Shabbat, I have to go to the synagogue. But what is the odds that I'm going to get the virus? Or what is the odds that I am, you know, contaminated, or I can spread the virus to another person? There's no problem. I don't care about other people's health. I don't care about other people's well-being. I only care about myself. I have to go to the synagogue because the Torah says every Shabbat I have to be at the synagogue. That is what the Yetzirah makes it to look like. It will make it to look as if you are doing the mitzvah which God has commanded. But actually, it has nothing to do with what God has commanded. It has to do with you, yourself. It has to do with each and every one of us. Because of what? Because we think that we are doing that which is right. And actually, we are committing a sin. Because if you go out and get people contaminated, you are committing a crime. If you go out to the synagogue and you get contaminated, you are doing yourself no good. That is what I'm trying to tell us, know each and every one of us. As I said, that our rabbi is saying that the mitzvah is we have to do the mitzvah according to what God wants us to do, not our own version of it. We don't have to misinterpret the mitzvah in the way to suit us. We have to do it according to the way God wants us to do it, not the way that we think we should do it. Intuition can play an important role in decision making, but it can be confused with the sense of insecurity that one often feels when having to walk counterintuitively. That can happen in time. Someone become accustomed to doing a mitzvah a particular way for a long period of time, and is then told to adopt a new whole way. The Gemara says that a person's prayer are only really heard when he is part of a minyan. In Brachat chapter 6a, that will certainly make it difficult not to go to one if you care about God hearing your prayers. This is especially so if you are someone who doesn't always put much intention into your prayers. However, just a few lines later, the Gemara say that if a person is prevented from doing a mitzvah for reasons beyond his control, from heaven's point of view, it is as if he actually did the mitzvah, as long as the person reasonably did his part in trying to do the mitzvah, nothing more is expected from him. So this is what the Gemara states, that even though if God is saying that for our prayer to be answered, we have to be in the minyan, that is in the quadrum of 10 men, of 10 people in the synagogue, but at the same time, the Gemara states that if for a reason beyond your control that you'll be prevented to go to the synagogue, but your intention, all this thing is based upon intention. That what I'm trying to let us understand here. If through a case that you cannot overcome, or in the case of the lockdown that they are saying is beyond your own control, you have to listen to what the government is saying. We have to stay home and get ourselves quarantined because we don't want to infect others, neither do we want to be infected. So in this case, it is beyond your control, but your state of mind is that as if you have done that mitzvah, that what God is saying. Because in your state of heart, you want to go to the synagogue, you want to praise God, you want your prayer to be answered. But this situation is beyond your own control. So God, what the heaven said is that it's as if you have done the mitzvah. You want to go to the synagogue, but the virus has you locked up at home. It is, if it weren't for the pandemic, you would have been dabbing at Amur, or at least saying a Kaddish for someone who has died. Not only will it count on behalf of the Niftar as if you did, but he will receive the additional merit of your doing the right thing, the halakha things, despite your internal opposition. That is true service of God. If it is hard to understand why God will shut down the social part of the Torah life, but he has. The virus is just the agent he used to do it, and not just the social part of the Torah life, but all those interactive parts of Torah life, like yeshiva boys helping to clean the for Pesach and other important things, shopping, food, and so on and so forth. So the Holy One, blessed be He, has used the virus to shut down these social activities, interaction between each and every one of us. But we have to understand that that is what He wants. If He doesn't want it, it won't have happened. There are a lot of conspiracy theory outside there. But if the Holy One, blessed be He, does not want it to happen, it won't have happened. So if it happened, that means that He allowed it to happen. So therefore, we have to do what? We have to do our own part and work together with the government of the day, you know, to make sure that it's minimized. This impact is minimized by what? By we not going out infecting people, or by we not be infected and bringing it home to infect our own family, or to infect your own children or your own wife. So it is very, very important for us to be able to work together with our government and to do our own part by obeying the instruction of the government. But as hard as this is to accept for us, it is what it wants. The bottom line is that we have to come to make sure that when we do the mitzvah of God, they are really the mitzvahs of God, not just our idea of them. When the mitzvah we do are not what God wants at the moment, no matter how much they were at other time, they end up being a sin instead. So the most important thing is for us to do the mitzvah of the Most High, not our own version of it. And we can read in the messianic writing that we read this morning, Hebrew chapter 8 from verse 1, saying that we have a better covenant, which is Yeshua HaMashiach has given us. That Yeshua HaMashiach self-sacrificed himself as the what? As the new Kohen Gadol, as it is written, on that Moshe should do what? Do everything according to what he had seen on the mountain. What did Moshe saw at the mountain? According to what it has been revealed to him, so shall you do the Mishkan. And Moshe Rabbeinu did everything according to the way it was shown on the mountain. And he taught Aaron and his son the way it was shown on the mountain. So therefore, it's like God is giving us, I just want to give us a little small analogy. 200 years ago, 100 years ago, 150 years ago, the car that we use, we can use it now because nobody will buy it. Understand? But when cars were first invented, it was the top of the town. Oh, wow, it is better than a horse. It can go faster, at least 50 kilometers an hour, 100 kilometers an hour. It is wonderful. Why a horse will take you 10 days, a car will be there in 2 hours. This is a great thing. This is a wonderful thing. But if they bring that car of 200 years ago or 150 years ago and give it to you now, you are going to reject it. You are going to say, oh, this is awful. I can't use this. That is no comfort. There is nothing there. No air conditioner, no heater, nothing. No video, no internet, none of this. But the car that we have now are like, you know, sophisticated things. You know, so the same thing here. In the days of the wilderness, God gave them the Mishkan, and the Mishkan is for them to see that this is the way it has been done. But God in His mind has upgraded this covenant, the covenant that has given to us, the covenant of our fathers. said, I have upgraded this covenant, this Kohen Gadol, into another level. And that is the level of grace. That is the level of love. And that is the level of us doing teshuvah. When we know that we did something wrong and something evil, we quickly make teshuvah to come back home. There is no need of animal sacrifice. In the heaven, I don't think they make animal sacrifice in the heavens. But the Torah said there is only one Qurban that will exist forever and ever. And that is the Qurban of praise. We will continue to, in the heavens, in the world to come, our work is to continue to praise God forever and forever. So therefore, the Holy One, blessed be He, through Yeshua HaMashiach, has given us this new dynasty. This new dynasty of Kohen Gadol, that through Yeshua HaMashiach, our new Kohen Gadol, He self-sacrificed Himself for us, so that we might have eternal life. For He said that, "He who believes in Me, I will raise up at the end day." He who believes in Me. And what does that mean? He who believes in the Torah, I will rise up at the end time. The Torah of Moshe is true. The Torah of Moshe is life. The Torah of Moshe is the tree of life that gives you life at the end day. If you take hold of it, say take hold of it and embrace it. Do not let it go. Take close tight into it, and at the end day, you will have life. That is what He's saying. And Yeshua HaMashiach is that living Torah that has come from heaven to show us the path of justice, the path of righteousness, the path of faith, not the path of religion. Not the path of religion, but the path of faith, the true faith of our fathers, of our forefathers, the faith of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Parasha Shemini, the selfless service. We can see that the Kohen Gadol truly are selfless men. They do the service of the living God according to the understanding, according to the teaching which God has taught them. It is not a selfish service. Most of us are doing selfish service because we want something in return. But the Holy One, blessed be He, is saying that we should do a selfless service, not expecting anything in return. But God Himself will repay us according to His riches in glory. Shabbat Shalom.